welcome to the fallout. Welcome to resistance. The tension is here. The tension is here. Dare you to run. Dare you to run. Dare you to run. Just so all about the floor. Dare you.
Hello, America, and welcome to the show. Robert Rowe, and you are listening to Awake Radio. Awareness Act Social Network, the social network for the aware. This is a social network for people who share some common ground, who share the fact that they are aware. Now, each has their own level of awareness, and each has their own issues that are most important to them. There are those who, like me, believe that gun rights are the most important issue to deal with right now. There are those who believe that the UN and its puppets are the most important issue to deal with right now. There are those who believe that developing higher spiritual awareness is the most important. At Awareness Act Social Network, there are people who believe in just about everything from Amazon forest preservation to Zionist conspiracies. No matter what your most important issue is, you are certain to find like-minded folks at AASN. But that isn't really a big deal because you can find them at just about any social network, right? There are so many of them out there, too. So why should anyone support Marshall Nelson's Awareness Act Social Network? Because there's one major difference between Awareness Act Social Network and most other social networks. AASN doesn't mine personal information, and it doesn't censor your free speech. Well, now there are limitations, of course. AASN does try to be a family-friendly site, so pornography and calls to violence are not allowed. But just about everything else is. If you're an Obama supporter, your opinions are welcome. If you're an Obama detractor, your opinions are welcome. If you support right-to-life positions, you're welcome. If you support right-to-choose positions, you're welcome. The point is, nobody gets censored simply because they disagree with popular mainstream rhetoric. And nobody gets censored because they disagree with Marshall. If you have a thought, idea, opinion, or statement, you're welcome to freely express yourself at AASN. That's what the social network is about. This idea has been welcomed by almost 10,000 members. AASN is growing at a rate that is difficult for the servers to keep up with. The current server is overloaded with the amount of traffic it is experiencing, making the AASN experience less than optimal during times of heavy traffic. New ideas for upgrades to the AASN experience have been put on hold because of this lack of server space. AASN needs more servers to handle the rapid growth, but we can't do it alone. We need your support. We need you to donate to the AASN Server Fund today. Please, if you can spare anything at all, even if it's only a couple of dollars, please consider contributing to the AASN Server Fund so we can keep this vibrant network growing. It is April 12th, 2013. In the news today, Bitcoin crashes one day after making bold predictions that its value will reach new levels. This has a very strong indication that those who are opposed to competition of Rothschild paper currency are engaged in sabotage. Kim Jong-un threatens missile launch again. The United States kind of laughed that off, though, and politely reminded them that we have the capability to shoot down anything they launch. Then the United States immediately canceled their own missile launch tests in the area. And Sheriff Joe Arpaio is in the news again. This time, an assassination attempt was thwarted by an observant postal carrier who noticed a package addressed to the sheriff had an extraordinary amount of postage on it. This caused a red flag to go off, and the box was x-rayed, revealing an explosive device contained within. Theories ranging from the Illuminati to the President of the United States being responsible for this attempt have been circulating the net. No evidence has been provided yet to prove any of these claims or support any of these claims. And the matter is under investigation by the Sheriff's Department. General Keith Alexander, director of the NSA, was asked today by a Fox News reporter if the Utah Data Center will hold the data of American citizens. And with a straight face, the general lied, saying, "No, we don't hold data on U.S. citizens, the people there at the NSA. They take protecting your civil liberties and privacy as the most important thing that they do in securing this nation." Right. A Fox News personality noted that the NSA has rules regarding such matters, but they are classified, so we just have to trust them. Trust the NSA, seriously? These people are trying to sell us a bridge of lies that spans from New York to London, and they want us to trust them? Okay, I'll let you decide. Today's topic, will you submit and obey, or will you be part of the resistance? Here's the thing, folks. They're coming. Whether we want to believe it or not, they're coming after our guns, they're coming after our children, they're coming after our homes, they're coming after everything that we have, and they're going to come quickly. They're going to come swiftly and silently and deadly. What are you going to do? Will you submit and obey, or will you be part of the resistance? This is, of course, a difficult question. Almost all of us are, well, let's face it, we're men and women of peace. We just want to be left alone to pursue our lives as we see fit. We don't go around harming people, at least not intentionally, and those who do usually pay their dues and get on with their lives. The point here is that we're not looking for a fight. At least I'm certainly not, and I really doubt you are. I have good reasons, though, not to look for a fight. My wife and daughter, for example, are a good reason for me not to be looking for a fight. And I'll be honest, like you, I don't particularly relish the idea of being wounded or killed. Not something high on my pleasure list. But there comes a time when a man has to say, enough is enough. There comes a time when a man must stand up for what's right, when he must fight for what he believes in, where he must draw the line in the sand and say no more. Well, my friends, if that time has not already arrived, it is rapidly approaching. The enemies of freedom and liberty are pushing their advantage because they wrongfully believe that we are against the ropes. They seem to think that they have the advantage. They have crossed a moral threshold from which they cannot retreat. If they retreat from this stand, they will have been exposed as weak and powerless, and their nefarious plans will all unravel. The power will return to the people, who are the rightful rulers of the United States of America. In other words, they are bringing the fight to us. Now, the resistance has already begun, and it isn't entirely without teeth. It's a small resistance at this point, but it is growing in power every day. In New York State, for example, the people have already begun resisting the unconstitutional gun registration laws recently enacted by that state's governing party. Across the nation, county sheriffs have made it known that federal enforcement of illegal gun laws will not be allowed within their counties. The special forces are making their position clear on the matter. Now, why is that important? Why is it important that the special forces are involved in this? Simply because the special forces are the people's teeth. It is the job of the special forces, according to their mandate, that if the government succumbs to tyranny, they are to fight on behalf of the people against the tyrannical government. These are the best trained warriors in the world. Navy SEALs, Green Berets, okay? These are the best. Army Rangers. Nobody is better at combat than these groups of warriors. Nobody. Their job, their task, their duty is to side with the American people in the event of a tyrannical takeover by our government. So when the special forces speak, the government must listen, because they know that if they piss off the special forces, they're in a shitload of trouble. I'm sorry. I promised I would try to cut down on my swearing. I apologize for that. Various state governments have also gotten involved and have informed the federal government that they will also resist any attempts to enforce any unconstitutional gun control laws. The federal government has made its position known, too. They consider anyone who opposes their agenda to be terrorists or enemies of the state. People across the country are being rounded up and put in prison for committing no crime whatsoever. Others are disappearing from the face of the earth or are being suicided by unscrupulous forces. Never before in our country's history have our own people existed in such a state of terror and fear of our own government. Now, there are many who believe that the government is attempting to create a utopian society, and that the means that they're using to create this utopian society justify what they're doing. Excuse me. Make no mistake about it, there is no utopia around the corner. There is only tyranny. There is only slavery. So again, the question becomes, what will you do? Will you submit to the ever-encroaching hand of tyranny, or will you stand for freedom, even knowing that doing so may cost you everything, including your life, or worse? As I stated before, I have a wife and daughter, so I'm very conflicted on this issue because of them. On the one hand, I want to ensure that I stay safe and alive in order to watch my daughter grow up, get married, have children, win a Nobel Peace Prize or something. On the other hand, I believe that if I don't stand and fight, the chances of her growing up in a world where she can achieve that goal are minimal. So, is it better to die to give her the chance to grow up in a free society, or is it better to remain alive and teach her the concepts of freedom and liberty, keeping that idea around for at least one more generation? I know it is very difficult to consider life in these terms, But these are the choices that are being thrust upon us by the enemies of freedom. We are being asked to make impossible decisions. Do we capitulate and become slaves, or do we fight for the chance to remain free, knowing that we may die? I don't want to make that choice. It is wrong on every level for freedom's enemies to force me into making that decision. Yet that's exactly what they're doing. We, the people, must declare our intentions and declare them soon. Because the government, the enemies of freedom, are taking away our choices. They're taking away our power. They are literally raping us, because that's what rape is. You take away the power. You take away the choice of the person being raped. What the government is doing is even worse. So let's make it clear. Gun registration is unconstitutional. Period. Background checks. Stupid in the first place, unconstitutional in the second place, and just plain old another way for the government to attempt to make purchasing guns more difficult. Just another way to make people pay more money for purchasing a gun. It amounts to a penalty on law-abiding citizens for having the audacity to exercise their Second Amendment right. Limiting magazine capacity is unconstitutional. Banning any weapon in common use by the public, such as semi-automatic pistols, or by the military, such as AR-15 style weapons, is unconstitutional. Limiting the quantity of ammunition or weapons one can possess is also unconstitutional. The Second Amendment doesn't read, "The right to bear arms shall not be infringed, and you can only have two guns." Doesn't say that. No federal agency, department, or office has any authority to place any restriction on gun ownership whatsoever, as this power is either prohibited by the Constitution or is not granted to them by the Constitution. The federal government has no authority over weapons or ammunition whatsoever, except as defined in the Constitution with regard to regulating commerce. They have the authority to tax them, in other words, but that is it. Their authority stops there. This is why you need to purchase your weapons now, because once this gun registration stuff fails, once the gun control measures fail, their next step is to tax them to the point that nobody will buy them, because they can't afford them. It will come down to a choice of, do I feed my children or buy a gun? If it comes down to that choice, obviously you're going to feed your children, because that's much more important. So they will tax them to the point that only the wealthy can afford the guns. And who are the people that are in power? Oh yeah, the wealthy. Killing Americans with drones is unconstitutional. I have no understanding how our current president can even begin to justify such an act. There is no need to use a drone that is 3 miles away, 15,000 feet in the air, to throw a missile at a person that they deem to be a threat to the United States. We have FBI for this. We have NSA for this. We have DHS for this. We have local police enforcement for this. We have sheriffs for this. We have state police for this. Why do we need a drone to lob a missile at somebody and potentially kill innocent people just because they want to get one bad guy? It boggles the mind to think that there are people who can actually justify that kind of behavior. Killing children of any nationality with American drones is illegal. And worse, it's immoral. Spying on Americans without a warrant is illegal. Yet, Utah Data Center is still there, isn't it? I tell you, it's just getting out of control. Censoring the internet for any reason is also illegal. It's also unconstitutional. Digital data mining by the government is illegal. It's not illegal for constitutions, by the way, just for the government. Detention of Americans without giving them their Miranda rights, without giving them access to legal counsel, and without giving them their day in court is unconstitutional. There is no way around that. No presidential directive, executive order, no law passed by Congress can supersede the constitutional mandate to due process. None do. Yet these are the things that the government has granted themselves the power to do without the consent of the people. We did not grant the government this authority. They just took it upon themselves to usurp that power. And it's up to you and me to take that power back. So how are we going to do that? In previous episodes, I've discussed the four boxes of freedom. We have to start exercising those rights. We have to engage those who are committing illegal acts. If it's illegal for me to coerce somebody into committing an illegal act, it's even more illegal for the government to do so. If it's illegal for me to create money out of thin air and loan it at interest to people, it's even more illegal for the Federal Reserve to do so. When I was a young teenager, my parents were involved in some kind of an anti-tax movement. This was back in the late 70s, early 80s, somewhere in that time. Being an engaged person myself, I would often go out to the neighborhood and I would gather the other teenagers and I would try to educate them as to the truth. Excuse me. I would tell them that we were going to live in a nation of oppression and it was our parents' fault because they let it happen. It was our grandparents' fault because they let it happen. They weren't aware enough to prevent the slow creep of tyranny. Now, I don't know if that position was right or wrong. But I do know that I don't want my daughter to have to make the same statements to her friends. I don't want her to say, "My father allowed this to happen. My parents allowed this to happen." What I want her to say is, "My father was one of those who stood their ground. He said, that's far enough. You must stop here." That's what I want her to say about me. What are your children going to say about you? Are they going to say, "My parents stood by, and let tyranny happen?" Or are they going to say, "Hey, my parents at least did something. They tried. They got out there and they said, you got to stop." They wrote the letters. They stood in protest. They did what they had the capacity to do to stop tyranny in its tracks. Or are your children going to say, "My parents took a stand and said no more. Here and no farther." Each of us has different capabilities. Each of us has different skills. It's understood that we can't all engage the enemy in the same manner, in the same way. But that doesn't excuse us from engaging. We must force the enemy to see us practicing our rights and let them know that they cannot prevent it no matter what. We must practice our freedom to assemble peaceably. You must get out there and protest. If you can't stand in protest, then sit in protest. If you can't sit, then lay in protest. If you must use a wheelchair to get to the protest, then wheel in protest. Hop in protest, jump, skip, bicycle, get on a damn pogo stick if you have to, but get out there and protest that which is wrong. If you can write opinion pieces to your local newspaper, then do so. If you can create a blog, then do so. If you can write letters to your senator or congressman, then do so. But get active in the fight. I don't know, and I don't pretend to know, whether or not the fight will end up violent. I certainly hope not, but only time will tell. But if it does, you'll have to make your decision. It's best if you make that decision right now and then prepare for it. If you decide to stand and fight, get yourself ready. If you decide you're going to resist by other means, then prepare yourself now. If you're going to capitulate, then do so now and get out of the way of those who are defending freedom and liberty. I'm Robert Rowe. I hope you enjoyed the show today. Thank you for listening. If you have any questions or comments for me, please email me at rrowe@awarenessact.com. That's rrowe@awarenessact.com. I hope you have a great day.
Oh, say can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight, o'er the ramparts we watched, were so gallantly streaming, and the rocket's red glare, the bombs bursting in air, gave